You know, I'm probably the only person who can honestly say I've beaten Mega Man X in black and white. And I'm actually playing this in black and white too, because of my setup, since, you know, this time I'm actually using component cables, so the game should hopefully look a lot crisper and more vibrant and more colorful and things like that. So because I'm doing that, I had to do some really awkward setup, which involved only getting stereo audio and black and white. It's complicated. It's a pain to describe. But anyway, right there, we entered Storm Eagle's stage, and right there, we just got a heart tank. Now, you may have noticed, why is your health bar so small? Do they really expect you to beat the entire game with such a low health bar? Well, I mean, you can do that. In fact, I've done it a few times myself. But what they actually intend for you to do is to grab heart tanks, which are scattered throughout all 8 levels. Once you've grabbed them, they increase your life by a small amount. They increase your maximum life bar, and that can come in handy. And if you want a self-imposed challenge, you can beat the game without getting any. And that is a really nice feature. I like that. The game introduces multiple ways to challenge yourself by getting through it. The heart tanks allow you to fill up your life to the boss level, and that's pretty neat. But here we are in Storm Eagle's stage, and one thing that I should also explain, just a little bit ago, I got an energy tank. Now, you may think that these work just like they do in the classic series, and you're sort of right, but this time, you can reuse them. So, like, instead, once you collect energy at full life, it will add to your sub-tanks. That way, you can reuse your sub-tanks as many times as you want. And also, I died right there. That is embarrassing. I'm editing that out. So one of the ways in which the X series differs from the classic series is the way that it handles its upgrades. For instance, the energy balancer is already something that you have from the start, or, well, basically, the energy balancer is a default part of your arsenal. Like, it's not actually an item in the X series, it's just an ability that you already have. And there are also capsules around the world that you can find, like this one right here.
This capsule contains an enhancement for your helmet, which will allow you to break some ceilings with a headbutt.
And this capsule, by the way, is almost completely useless, so why am I getting this one second? Because it's necessary to get the arm upgrade, which we'll be getting in the next stage. And it's really stupid that, like, this is the only use for it, but it is. I mean, maybe it can, like, block some falling rocks, but it's pretty situational and useless. It's not very good, and I don't like it. And because, like, Dr. Light has put all sorts of capsules around the world with pre-recorded messages, you know what that means, right? Dr. Light is Hari Seldon. Yes, that's probably going to be the title of this video, in fact, because, you know, it seems like the obvious comparison. Earlier, the opening of the game did reference the first law of robotics, so, you know, I suspect there is some connection. But I digress. One thing that I don't like is that several of the stages just have long lines of, like, nothing going on. And it's like, slopes help somewhat, but they're not, like, a perfect solution to this. Because, like, it's just not very interesting when there's a long line of stuff with the occasional enemies challenging you. That's not very interesting. And I'm also not much of a fan that you don't start off with the dash. Like, yeah, I get that they were trying to, like, ease people into the X series, but I mean, the wall jump is also an ability that is in your default arsenal, and that wasn't in the Classic series. That was still considered something that was good enough to be a default part of your moveset. So, why couldn't the dash be the same way? The lack of a dash is really annoying. It makes getting through the intro stage kind of annoying, and it's probably one of the reasons why I think it's a bit overhyped, the intro stage. And I wouldn't mind it as much if it weren't so dragged out. But the Storm Tornado, which we got from Storm Eagle, is amazing. It is this game's Metal Blade. Like, it is just so good, so incredible, because, like, it just tears through enemies right ahead of you, and it just obliterates everything in sight. Another upgrade that's become a default ability in the X series would be the Escape Unit, which in the Classic series you had to collect an item that would allow you to exit stages you've beaten, except in Mega Man 11 where you could just do that by default. And right here is the arm part, which is really good. I wish I could get it sooner, but here we are. I don't think it's as hard to get at some other people, but then again, I've had a lot of practice, so...
This capsule contains a part which will increase the capabilities of your X-Buster. You can use it to fire all types of weapons.
And so what that means is that you can, instead of firing just up to 2 levels of charge for your charge shot, now you can do 3. And this is pretty neat. It's not as amazing as you may think, but the real reason I wanted it was because it allows you to charge special weapons. And this is an awesome feature, because unlike the Classic series, the X series allows you to charge the special weapons as well as your default X-Buster. So that is really awesome, and that's a feature that I'm glad is a staple in the X series. And it's really nice getting alternate uses out of weapons. It's also why I like the power gear in Mega Man 11, but I digress. It comes in handy quite a bit, and some weapons are going to be very useful with this. In fact, there's a part coming up in Sigma's Fortress, which we'll need that in order to get through it. But the Storm Tornado, by the way, is really good for taking out the USB Joes, or whatever they're called, because it can just tear through them like no problem. And on the info card, it says that the Japanese name for Flame Mammoth is Burnin' Nowmander. And for the record, yes, the apostrophe is in the Japanese version, so that's not just something I'm adding. Like, it's actually spelt with an apostrophe. Now, what's a Nowmander? Well, this is an interesting story, because I did some research and I found out that, in fact, Flame Mammoth isn't actually a mammoth at all. He's instead based on Paleoloxodon Naumani, which is an extinct type of elephant that isn't even particularly large as far as elephants go. It's, I believe, smaller than the Asian elephant, in fact. But sometimes it's actually called Naumann's elephant, named after the discoverer who went by the name of Naumann. And he actually made a paper about it. And it was discovered in Japan, actually. So that could actually be the reason why he's based off of Naumann's elephant. And it's also possibly why he's called Burn and Naumander. So that's an interesting story. But anyway, here's his stage without having beaten Chill Penguin. The lava isn't frozen over, and it's actually pretty neat. It's not something a lot of people see. I feel I should show this off because, you know, I want this LP to be, like, as thorough as I can make it. But other people just don't see this a lot because they normally just tackle Chill Penguin first. That's one thing that I feel I should discuss. As I was saying, I'm not a fan that, like, they didn't make the dash a default part of your moveset. And it's like, you can beat the other stages without having cleared Chill Penguin, but this game really was not designed with the lack of a dash in mind, because some of the bosses are just annoying to fight without the dash, because they can move so fast and be a pain in the neck to dodge. It's like, they really did not intend for you to tackle anyone other than Chill Penguin first. And it's like, it's sort of an obnoxious compromise where, like, they try and ease the classic series players in, but, like, also make it so that it's annoying to play without using the dash. It's like, you can't have it both ways. Either design it with the dash in mind and make it a default part of your moveset, or just design it without the dash in mind. You can't really have both, I feel. You may be wondering, like, what the various upgrades I've picked up are, but basically each game has a minimum of 4 parts. You have the arm parts, the leg parts, body parts, and the head parts. And what these all do varies from game to game, but typically the arm parts increase your firepower and often allow you to charge special weapons. Meanwhile, the leg parts increase your dashing ability or just general agility. The body parts usually increase your defense, and the head parts can vary wildly, from breaking ceilings to allowing you to heal by standing still to giving you infinite weapon energy. So that one is the most variable part across the series, and some games include more than one set of armor, but this game's set of armor is known collectively as the first armor. And these bosses here are easy. Now we've come up to Flame Mammoth again. And, you know, just for the sake of it, I'm just gonna beat Flame Mammoth again. And this time without his weakness. So hopefully that should go over well. I mean, that's embarrassing that I died to him with his weakness. earlier. There's no excuse for that. He's an easy boss, actually. Most of the bosses are easy. I mean, they weren't designed without the dash in mind, so, you know, that could be problematic. Stages in general just aren't as fun without the dash. I mean, it's a good thing you can get it early on, but still it's annoying. And I still ended up managing to defeat him without that. So anyway, when we beat him, we're rewarded with the Fire Wave. And this is another amazing weapon because it can just tear through everything. That's one thing, a lot of the weapons in this game are amazing. I mean, not everyone, the Spark Shot, I mean the Electric Spark is kinda lame. However, a lot of them are pretty useful. The Shotgun Ice, or as I call it, the Ice Shotgun, is really useful for taking out a lot of enemies that go down in one hit. It does a decent amount of damage too, so it's pretty useful to have the Shotgun Ice, especially when you're surrounded by a bunch of enemies and you want your shots to ricochet off of the walls. Meanwhile, the Storm Tornado is great for taking out enemies right in front of you, although it can't fire in, like, multiple directions, so that's where other weapons come in. So it's like, unlike the Metal Blade, which was something that could do so many neat things because, like, it could fire in all eight directions, a lot of people overlooked the other weapons. However, I don't really feel that that's the case for Mega Man X, because the weapons in this game are all really well balanced. Again, most of them, not all of them, are great. And later on, we'll be getting the homing torpedo, which is pretty good, but honestly, I don't think I like it as much as the dive missile or whatever Searchman's weapon was, because, like, it's not as fast and it's a little cumbersome, but I do still enjoy it for similar reasons. It's a homing weapon, and of course, a homing weapon comes in handy quite a lot. I feel that these stages all have too much of an emphasis on combat. That's, like, the main thing that kind of bothers me, is that, like, the classic series featured platforming challenges as one of the main challenges to these games, but this game just doesn't try platforming as much, and it's a shame too, because with the wall jump, it does open up the possibilities to some very unique platforming. And we'll see more of that later on in the series. And while I do like the game's story, I think it's poorly executed, because, like, it's not really good at providing context. I mean, like, in the game itself, you're never really told who Sigma is. You're just sort of told that, hinted that, like, he was a former Maverick Hunter because, like, of, like, one line later on that he says. And, like, you're also not given much context as to who Zero is because, like, he doesn't show up all that often, and then he just sort of doesn't really play much of a major impact in the story. Like, I get what they were going for. It's a story that's ultimately about growth, and that's pretty neat. And it's cool that they tried to tackle that with, like, a video game format. However, I don't think it's done particularly well in this game because of the lack of context. And, like, Vile shows up in the opening, but, you know, he doesn't show up at the end, like, he's not the final boss, which, you know, I get that they wanted to make Sigma the final boss, but then why couldn't he be the one who shows up in the intro stage? One thing that I haven't talked about all that much is the music, and the music to this game is fantastic. It's not my favorite set of music in the X series. I know a lot of people do consider this to be, like, their favorite in terms of music, but I disagree. It's still a fantastic set of music, but, you know, I do think there are better games in the series in terms of a soundtrack. So I should probably talk about this boss. Basically, Boomer Kuwanger, he teleports all across the room, and a good strategy is just fire like a crazed chimpanzee. Just use regular shots. He's a little annoying because of RNG to fight. The info card, by the way, says that his Japanese name was, in fact, Boomer Kuwanger, just like the US name. This is the only Maverick in Mega Man X, in the first Mega Man X, where the Japanese and US names are the same. This doesn't happen a lot, so, like, most people are probably wondering, what on earth is a Kuwanger? Well, apparently it comes from the Japanese word kuwagata, which is the Japanese word for stag beetle. So really, he's Boomer Stag Beetle, but I guess they thought, like, oh, that's not catchy, but, like, why not just go for Boomer Beetle, or, like, Boomerang Beetle? Hey, it works for, like, Gravity Beetle. So, like, why couldn't that work? That'd make sense. But now we're tackling Sting Chameleon's stage, and it's pretty good. It's one of my favorite stages in the game. One of my favorite Maverick stages, at least. Also earlier, Storm Eagle's Japanese name is Storm Eagle. Storm Eagle? Storm Eagle? I don't know, that is just weird. I don't get what's up with the Japanese and, like, this almost English stuff. It's very disorienting and strange, but now I'm here to actually get to the body part. But in order to get the body part, you have to fight a very annoying mini-boss, Buster Simcus. We get to fight against Buster Simcus in order to get the body part. And of course, because we're fighting against Buster Simcus, this must mean Batboy is nearby. Or something like that. Batboy, the movie, featuring Batboy. With Buster Simcus, starring the Weekly World News as Batboy's son. I'm not sure how an entire pop publication is one person, but okay, we'll just roll with it. I've always thought that, like, the name Buster is a funny name, and Simcus is also funny. So I think Buster Simcus is a very hilarious name, at least in my eyes. And who is Buster Simcus? Just Google it. His last name is spelled S-I-M-C-U-S. In case you're wondering how to spell it, that's how it's spelled.
This capsule contains a new type of body armor. It will reduce damage to your systems by 50%.
It's a very funny name, I find. That mini-boss has been suspected to be connected to Otto in some way, because, like, it looks so similar to Otto, so it's possible that there is a connection, but, like, I can't really think of what that would be, or if it'd even be particularly meaningful. It's just something I felt I should point out. we're coming up to an extra life that is very easy to get, and it's only guarded by a Pizza Joe, or whatever they're called. Pizza Joe, is that like Pizza John or whatever? Now I'm having a brain fart and I can't seem to think. Is Pizza John correct? Now I'm not sure. Has it been something else all this time? Or am I just getting confused? It's time for an explanation about body parts. Well, whereas in this game it only just decreases the damage you take, in future games it also introduces a Giga Attack, which is what happens when, after taking enough damage, you can use the Giga Attack to make a huge attack that, like, damages everything in sight, or, like, has a very wide reach. And I'll be talking more about that when I get to Mega Man X2 and whatnot, but for now, that's what future games introduce. But one thing that I should have talked about by now is, the X series actually introduces vehicles, and the most prominent one would be the ride armor, which allows you to dash and punch things and, like, go around and just tear through things without taking any damage to your health bar. It's pretty cool, but these don't really amount to a whole lot. I just felt it's worth mentioning that, like, this game introduces the ride armor, and future games will introduce other vehicles like the Ride Chaser. Anyway, Sting Chameleon's Japanese name is Sting Chameleo. Sting Chameleo. Sting Chameleo. Sting Chameleo. I have no idea, that is bizarre. I don't get what's up with this, like, pseudo-English. It's, like, close enough to English to make me doubt that I'm a native speaker of English. And Sting Chameleon's weapon, by the way, is the Chameleon Sting, which is just his name reversed. That's kind of funny. I do genuinely love this game. I know I've been harping on it a bit, but that's just because I wanted to be as fair as possible. I mean, this is the game that got me into the X series, and there's a reason for that. It is really good. I love the design, I love the levels and the way they flow nice. I mean, with the dash. The weapons are awesome, the music is pretty good, and the bosses are fun to fight. There's just a lot to love about this game. I mean, like, there's a reason that I've beaten this game, like, over 30 times or so. I have practiced this game like there's no tomorrow. I've been able to beat this game without the armor and without any heart tanks, so yeah, that takes some practice, but that will have to be it for this episode. This is the Mississippi King signing out, and in the next episode, we'll take on the remaining three Mavericks. See y'all then.